So God gives evangelists to equip the saints for the work of ministry, and that's what I want to do. And I can tell you from a biblical standpoint, as well as from an experiential standpoint, the difference, because even just evangelizing, like, my goal, honestly, is not just to get you to evangelize. That is not my goal anymore. Anyway, I'm not going to keep going. My goal isn't just to get you to evangelize. My goal is to get you to evangelize for the right reasons, with the right motives, with the right things empowering you and pushing you. Does that make sense? You can tithe a lot of money, slap it in the plate, and God be completely not happy with you, right? I mean, you can, if you're not giving that money from the right heart. And that's why, like, I'm hoping that this class really will change our hearts to evangelize for the right reasons, with the right power, as we move forward. And so with my story a little bit, because I grew up in a Christian home, because I grew up going to church, Christian school, things like that, I've been evangelizing for a really long time, a lot longer than I've been following Christ. Kind of weird, but that's true. Like, I think it's just part of who I am. Don't give me any credit. I'm also the guy that jumped out of the second story window at school. I'm just not afraid of doing things. You know what I mean? Like, that's just how God wired me. It doesn't make me any better that I've been sharing the gospel for a long time, but I just am not that scared to walk up to people and start talking to them. And so why did I share the gospel? So that why was I sharing the gospel before I even cared about Jesus? I think there are several reasons. I knew that I was supposed to. You know, Jesus says, follow me and I'll make you fishers of men. I'm like, okay, well, I guess I need to be a fisher of men. I'm going to start doing that. Secondly, and this one sounds good, but it's not the complete answer, I knew that without this message of the gospel that people would go to hell. I didn't want people to go to hell, so it seems like a pretty mean thing to do to not tell people about it. And so those were my two reasons for sharing the gospel. I knew I was supposed to, and so I more or less begrudgingly did it, and because I didn't want people to go to hell. Those aren't terrible reasons, but the problem is they weren't God-glorifying reasons from the way I was looking at it, my heart in it. And so, honestly, my sharing of the gospel lacked persuasion. So, like, it was more or less me telling someone to put on a red shirt instead of a blue shirt. It's like, are you really passionate about the red shirt? I wasn't passionate about them accepting Jesus or anything like that, any more than, like, I don't want you to go to hell, you know. I just didn't have this persuasion, this joy, and I don't know. I've got so many things I can say that are just politically incorrect, so I'm trying not to. But one thing I say with the gospel that I understand now that I did not then is we're not trying to sell people a turd. Like, we're not trying to sell them something. Yeah. That's my politically incorrect statement for the day, and I'm done with that. But, like, that's just the only way I know to say it is, look, I'm not trying to get you to take something that is bad for you. I'm trying to give you the world. And I just didn't have that understanding then. I just wanted them to get out of hell. Like, hey, you're about to get hit by a car. Like, get out of the way. Like, that was the way I thought of it. I didn't realize, get out of the way of the car and, like, move into this mansion and, like, this beautiful thing. The gospel is so much more exponentially that way. And so what changed in me? Like, I told you about 7 years ago or so, same time I started coming here, God changed my world. And the biggest thing that changed for me, both with salvation and with sharing the gospel, is I realized one essential truth that I did not realize before, and that is that God is awesome. You know, I grew up singing the song, Our God is an Awesome God. I knew it, you know, but I didn't know it. Like, I really didn't. I didn't think of God as, like, this awesome, amazing being, that if none of you existed, none of my closest friends existed, yet I had God, I would have satisfaction. I didn't think that way. I never realized that God is awesome. I don't know, I don't want to go too long on that. But basically what happened for me, you know, I told you I grew up in Christian school, Christian family, all that, church, and it actually took me falling into deep sin, right, and then seeing, hey, God still loves me in spite of my deep sin. Like, that's a crazy gracious God. God still sent his son to die for me in my place for my sins, even these big ones. That's an awesome God. God still not only wants to save me from my sins, but give me eternity with him. That is an awesome God. Like, that was just that really is just scratching the surface. That might be the brightest shining example of God's awesome character. But that is what changed for me. All of a sudden, I wanted everyone to know about this God. And so that was the change. And I'm going to break that down a little bit, what was going on. But basically, what I want to say is what changed is I saw the glory of God. And that's using our biblical terms, I know. But I saw the glory of God, and it changed my whole reasoning for sharing the gospel. And for that, I'm going to give us some foundational definitions. These are actually on your outline. So I'm finally to your outline. But some foundational definitions. And this is just to make sure we're all on the same page, because we can use these words and forget what they actually mean. And our first one is worth. Worth is our first word that I want to give a definition for. And obviously I'm looking for the worth of God, or the worth of whatever thing you love. And that is the intrinsic value of something or someone. You see that there? The intrinsic value of something or someone. I'll continue on that here in a moment, but I put the intrinsic value because that is its worth. Like I don't know, I really can't think of any other good example for that, but it is worth that. It does have that value. You cannot take away that value. You can't add to that value. It is the intrinsic worth, the intrinsic value of that thing. And I put there, it should be noted that we are born with a flawed but functioning value system. If our value systems were perfect, we would see that God is worth more than anything by millions and millions of miles. Like, we would recognize that. Yet so often, we pick sin over God. So value system, he was just talking about, he was joking about the gluten-free diet. Anyways, but like, our value systems sometimes aren't correct. Like, sometimes we would pick that milkshake, that dessert, over our health. Even though we know it, there's just still like, you know what? I still value that milkshake more. And we do it. We just passed the holiday season, so I think you know what I'm talking about. That sometimes our value system is skewed. But again, the pleasure of sin over God. I pick that every day. I wish that weren't true. That whether in small measure or big measure, I pick the pleasure of some sort of sin, whether that be what I don't do or what I do, over God. And so it shows that my value system is messed up. So worth, the intrinsic value, what it is worth. Worship is the next one, the next definition we need to have. And that is to attribute worth or value to something or someone. So to worship something is to attribute, to show that it is what you believe it to be worth, or what value you believe it have. And we do this by the inward inclination of the heart. So that is, we feel, we believe, we know that thing to be worth or not worth that way. And then two, and by the outward manifestation of giving time, attention, and resources to this person or thing. So you have the inward inclination of the heart. This shows worship. This is the way you feel about something. And obviously when we're talking about God, it is, how is God worth my attention? You know, like, is he even worth that? So you have that inclination, and then it is shown in worship by actually spending that time. Is it worth me turning off the TV for 10 minutes to open up my Bible, or is it not? That is what worship is. We show how much we worship. I put here, worship requires the sacrifice of other lesser things by giving to the one rather than the other. And so that TV thing to read the Bible is a good example. I have to sacrifice a lesser thing, a lesser value, a lesser worth thing by turning it off in order to obtain more of another. And that's just a fact of life. So moving on, these next ones are very similar, but I'm, again, just giving definitions because I'm going to be using words like worship and worth and glorify and glory. So the next one, glory, is the weightiness or honorableness, which I don't think is a word, by the way. It might be, but honorableness. Shakespeare did it. He made up tons of words. I can do it. The weightiness or honorableness of something or someone. So glory. When we say God has glory, this is that he is honorable. This is, this intrinsic worth and value of weight and honorableness about God. You know, when we turn open the beginning pages of the Bible or whatever, we just see this God who speaks and the world is created. Like, that is a weighty God. You look at this God, you go further into, you know, Exodus, or you look at Noah, who brings a flood. But Exodus, who does all these, the plagues, and, you know, crushes the people in the Red Sea. Like, that is a weighty, honorable God. And so God, for instance, is glorious, right? He has glory. This is not something that we add or take away from God. He is glory. He has worth. And then to glorify, much like worship, is to attribute weight or honor to something or someone by the same things as worship, by the inward inclination of the heart and by the outward manifestation. But you don't have to worry about that. But like to glorify God means it is to show that he is glorious. It is to show that he is worth honor, that he is worth praise, that he is weighty. And you can think of this with so many different things, that the way we act. Again, I'm not going to go too far into this stuff, so I'll just pause right there. But glory, God is glorious. And remember, I told you, the thing that changed for me was realizing that God is awesome. That's just another way of saying that God is worthy and God is glorious. And so what I wasn't doing, that I now try to do, is I wasn't worshiping him. I wasn't showing the worth that he has, and I wasn't glorifying him. I wasn't showing the weight and honorableness that he has. And so I put this, I want to ask you a question, though, too. What is the greatest command? Anyone?
Love God with all your heart, with all your soul, and all your understanding.
Great, and we pause there because we don't have the second yet. But we'll get to the second command. So the greatest command, Jesus was asked this by some people. What is the greatest command? You know, is it not to lie, not to kill, is it, you know, not to make an idol? It is to love the Lord your God with all your heart. The greatest command. And it has the other things, you know, strength and all these things. But the greatest command, love the Lord your God. That is the greatest command. Yet, we look at our world, and even ourselves at times, sadly, but we look at our world, and we have a lot of people, right, who are not loving the Lord their God. They don't even recognize him as God. You know, I don't know what the percentage is, and I think percentages are probably skewed on how many people in America and in the world are actually Christian, born again, have been, you know, indwelt by the Holy Spirit. The numbers are low, and that means there are a lot of people who do not love God, who do not glorify God, who do not worship God. And the problem is, God is glorious. He deserves that worship. He deserves that praise from people. And so we're going to get further into this, but I'm going to tell you this. I don't just want you to evangelize. Evangelism is not the point. You see that in your notes? Evangelism is not the point. God being worshiped and glorified is the point. Evangelism exists because people do not rightly worship and glorify God. So we just talked about that. Evangelism only exists because people don't worship and glorify God. In heaven, there will be no evangelism. Everyone who is in heaven will be worshiping and glorifying God, so there will be no reason to do it. Evangelism here and now is a means to glorify and worship God by sharing his story so that others worship and glorify him as well. And you might not, but John Piper's Let the Nations Be Glad, he talks about missions in the same way. He says missions exist because people don't glorify God. And so that's what we have, is my desire for you is that we can rightly organize our motives why. That's today. Why share his story? To rightly organize these things. And it is, I'm humbled to pass these things along, because I know how disorganized my mind is on these things, that I still sometimes do this out of duty rather than delight. But here we go anyways. Number one, so here are reasons to share his story. Number one, sharing is worship that displays the preeminent glory of God. Sharing is worship that displays the preeminent glory of God. And so this is our primary reason. This should be our 100% primary reason for sharing the gospel. See, you remember I told you I used to do it out of duty. I'm supposed to, you know, and because I don't want people to go to hell. God wasn't even on my radar. God getting glory. I was more worried about the person not going to hell, and I was worried about me not failing in some area and feeling bad about it. But the preeminent reason that we're supposed to share is to display, to show the worth of God in these different ways, because he is glorious. So I'm going to show you different ways that God is shown glorious when we share the gospel. That first one is God is shown with his creator right of judgment. his creator right of judgment. Someone want to read that one for me? The Romans there, 24 and 25.
Therefore, God gave them up to, in the lust of their hearts to impurity, to the dishonoring of their bodies among themselves, because they exchanged the truth about God for a lie and worshipped and served the creature rather than the created, who is blessed forever. Amen.
There we go. So what we have is, I put there, see also Genesis 1 and 2. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. You know, in this day he created this. God created everything. God created everything and created everything and deserved to be worshipped. He deserved to be glorified. And yet what happened in chapter, is it 3, I guess? I don't know. Yeah, I guess it's 3 is the fall. In chapter 3, they refused to give him the honor that he is due. And this continued in everyone, and that's why God gave them up to the lust of their hearts. And it says there, because they exchanged the truth about God for a lie. So what's the truth about God? They exchanged the fact that God is awesome, that God created them and rightfully can tell them what to do, for the lie that they can be autonomous, that they can worship themselves, do what they want to do. That's what's kind of going on in this verse. And they worship and serve the creature rather than the creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. God, this, by the way, more and more, that fact, and we'll talk about this in greater depth later, but that fact is something that we can't take, what is the word I'm looking for? People don't necessarily know that anymore. They used to be, people just thought, okay, God created us, and they knew what sin meant. Sin meant, you know, dishonoring your creator. But people don't understand that anymore. And so when we tell the gospel, we're telling them, hey, God created you. He owns you. You rebelled against him. God should be glorified in that way, in his rightful place. The second thing it shows is that God is shown as our greatest need. So God's not only shown as our creator, but as our greatest need. verse
623,
Greg, you got that?
Yeah, absolutely. For the wages of sin is death.
Boom. So that's just the first part of Romans 6:23. Hallie, you want to read that next Ephesians thing?
Sure. And you were dead in your trespasses and sins, in which you once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience, among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the spirit, of the body and the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, like the rest of mankind.
So man had a problem, right? Man had the problem. They had this need. I am dead. I am spiritually dead. The wages for my sin, for rebelling against his creator God, was death. I was dead in my trespasses and sins. I was following the prince of the power of the air, the course of this world, all these things. I was a children of wrath. I was a child of wrath. I was just awaiting God's wrath. He's my greatest need. So the next thing we see, building off of that, is God is shown as the greatest Savior. You got that one for me, Andrew?
Yes, sir. But the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord.
So we saw that first. The wages of sin is death. We rightly deserve death. The wages of sin is death. But our great Savior, through him, we have eternal life, this free gift of eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Angie, you got the 4-6 there.
May God, being rich in mercy because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved and raised us up with him and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus.
So we see that we were dead in our trespasses and sins, and the greatest need. You guys see that I'm doing that, right? I'm finishing the verses in this second part. So I was dead. I was awaiting this wrath, but God. And if you've ever heard a sermon on those passages, on that passage, that "but God," like, that is our hope right there, right? We were dead. We were destitute. We could not save ourselves. We had offended the God of the universe, but God made us alive together with Christ and raised us up. He did all these things as the greatest Savior. But there's something wrong with that, as we know. Okay, God, so you just wiped away the bad things I did. I really need to think of a better example for this. but, okay, so your car is parked down the parking lot right now. Someone steals it, right? They wreck it, so the police catch them. and the cop catches them, and you're standing there, and the cop says, you know what? Let's just let them go. Let's just forget this ever happened. You're like, but my car's screwed up, right? Like, I messed up. Like, justice says that guy will sit in court, that he'll have to pay for my car, or at least insurance will, and he'll do time for the thing that he's done wrong. Now, with God, how much worse would it be for him to watch us grossly sin and just say, you know what, I'm just going to wipe it away? I can think of really bad examples. This is where, again, I don't want to say politically incorrect things, but think of the worst things that could be done by someone to another person, you know, and for God to say, oh, you know what, it's okay. You know, I don't know if you or someone in your family or if close friend has been sinned against grossly, but you want that person punished. You want that wrong done to them punished. And God, to be just, has to punish that sin. And so that's what we see here. God remains just, upholding justice by judging sin. God did not wipe sin under the rug. He didn't wipe sin under the rug. He paid for it in Jesus Christ. It says there in 1 John 1:9. Yeah, that Jason? Is it Jason, right?
Yeah.
Okay. You see it, 1 John 1:9?
Don't have
that
page,
sorry.
Really? I'll read it. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all.
All right, thank you. I'm sorry. I don't know why you don't have that page. Yeah, so, but what we have there, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just. That's that word, that just word. It is showing his justice, that he doesn't just sweep it under the rug. And as we know, the reason he's able to do that is because our sins were put on Jesus. They were punished. The wages of sin was death, and death was dealt to Jesus. The death you deserved, but spiritual and physical, was dealt to Jesus. And so God is shown as just by judging sin. God is shown glorious, right? We're showing, he's being worshipped. That's this number one. Sharing is worship that displays the preeminent glory of God. The next one we have there is God displays the greatest sacrifice by taking judgment on himself. I already kind of explained that one. Is it Angela? Angela. That's so close. You got that one for me?
Uh-huh. For our sake, he made him to be sin who knew no sin.
And so we just talked about that. But that is amazing that the sacrifice was paid by the one who was sinned against. So it would be, you know, the car wreck happens, and the cop says, you know what, we're taking him in, and he's going to spend all this time in jail. And you say, you know what? I'm going to pay for it, you know? Like, it's actually okay that he did that. I'd like to not press charges. I'm not sure if that actually worked in the legal system, but I will pay for that car. You know what? He stole my car. He clearly needs a car. I'm going to buy him a car. Well, that would probably be the next point, that he's gracious to us. But so God was sinned against grossly. Remember, we talked about when we want this justice, it is because this sin has been so grossly done and deserves the punishment. But God says, you know what? Even though I was the one done wrong, I will pay the sacrifice by taking the judgment on myself. And that's why he sent his son. He made him to be sin who knew no sin. The next one is God displays the greatest grace, I should have thought about that, by giving forgiveness, righteousness, new life, and eternity. So again, using that car analogy, he not only says, I'll pay for the damages, he says, you know what, he clearly needs a car, so I'm going to buy him a car, and it's going to be nicer than my car. That's what God did. You got that next one for me? I don't even know.
So that in him we might become the righteousness of God.
Yeah, so there you go, that's good. So in him, he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Again, I'm connecting those two verses. Does that make sense? Like, the sacrifice was paid. Not only was the price paid, but addition was given so that we might become the righteousness of God, the very thing that we need so bad. You got that one for me, Joe? Next one.
Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away, and behold, the new has come.
And these are just great promises. This is, we've sinned against God. We don't deserve this life. And so this again, let's see here. This again is showing people, like, hey, my God is worthy of your worship. You know, so often we tell people, you know, you need salvation because you're going to burn in hell, and I don't want that for you. No, tell them, like, hey, my God is worthy of your worship. Like, he is that awesome. Like, you should want to worship my God. And in that, God is worshipped, right? Because we said worship is attributing that worth to him. We believe it in our heart, and we show it by our actions and our words in these things. The next one we have, our obedience shows the worth of obeying God. Did everyone already read? We already know this one.
I have John.
Okay. You were late, so we kind of...
Yeah, you just ignore me. The rest of the class.
Anyone else want to read it?
And Jesus came and said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always, to the end of the age."
So all these, I'm putting verses there, and there are probably way better verses I could even use on these. But we have go, therefore, and make disciples. We are commanded to do this. And part of what is glorifying to God is showing, you know what, I'm going to obey you. I want to obey you. And God is shown glorious in that as well. Many times I tell people when I'm sharing the gospel with them, like, hey, I'm kind of freaking out about sharing the gospel with you. Like, it's hard for me to do this. Like, I'm nervous that you'll judge me and that, you know, I'll screw up our friendship or something like that. But you know what? I want God to receive worship from you. I want you to know him. I usually don't tell them that part, like, that I want God to receive worship from you. I'm more so on the side of I care about you. But it's hard for them to understand the glory of God part yet. But that should be our primary focus, is that God deserves worship and praise, and he isn't getting it. And so we need to share these things. And I believe God is shown most glorious in the gospel. Ephesians chapter 1, I think, but three times it talks about that this salvation happens, to the praise of his glorious grace, to the praise of his glory. Like, and then I can't remember what the third one is exactly, but I think that's Ephesians 1. That's what the gospel is about God receiving his glory. All right, number two, the second reason, this is a secondary reason, and it's number two. Anyway, bless you.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Anyway, sharing gives others the opportunity for right worship and joy. Sharing gives others the opportunity for right worship and joy. All right, so the greatest commandment is to love the Lord your God, and the second one is like it.
Love your neighbor.
Love your neighbor as yourself. That's exactly right. And so we're really just following through with the greatest commands. The first greatest command is to love God. I want God to receive the worship he's due because I love him. And then secondly, I want people to receive this salvation because it is the best thing for them. And reasons I have there for that is people will not see the worth and glory of God without hearing the gospel. Does anyone want to read this? I feel bad making you guys read it if you don't want.
I will.
Okay.
"For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved." I'll bring it to him. "How then will they call on him in whom they have not believed? And how are they to believe in him of whom they have not heard? And how are they to hear without someone preaching?"
Paul was the great logical person. Oh, I didn't even put the verse reference there. But anyway, I put it below. Anyway, these verses is just basically saying, like, hey, anyone who calls on the name of the Lord Jesus as their Savior and Lord, they will be saved. They will have their whole life changed. They'll have their whole eternity changed. But how then will they call on him of whom they have not believed? They have to believe in him that he can actually save them of their sins or forgive them and bring them salvation. But how are they to believe in him of whom they've never heard? It only makes sense they can't believe in him of whom they've never heard. And how are they to hear without someone preaching or sharing, whatever you want to think? And that's where we come in, right? These people could have the salvation that changes them from death to life, from hell to heaven for eternity. But they can't believe on someone of whom they've never heard. And so we have to be that someone who shares the gospel with them, because otherwise they could not, they can't trust in God. The next one there is, people will not have the opportunity for the joy of knowing God without the gospel. Again, this is just me reminding you that you're offering them the greatest possible gift. right? We bring you tidings of great joy, like the angel said, good news, tidings of great joy. Like, that's what this is, that this is the greatest news ever, that they could have the joy of knowing God, and they wouldn't have that without us sharing the gospel. The next one there, people will spend eternity in hell without the gospel. This is kind of similar. Hallie, you got that one for me?
Yeah. Then death and Hades were thrown into the lake of fire. This is the second death, the lake of fire. And if anyone's name was not found written in the book of life, he was thrown into the lake of fire.
There you have it, lake of fire, hell. That's what we have is if they do not hear this. A lot of people would like to take this out of the Bible, the fact that hell exists, that God does, in fact, judge people for the sins that they've committed for eternity. But that's the reality of it, is if they don't put their trust in Christ, then they have to pay for their own sins, the wages for their sins. And then here, I guess I already said that, but sharing will ultimately bring them the greatest joy if they accept it. Grant, you want to read that Psalms for me there?
Blessed is the one whose transgression is forgiven, whose sins covered. That Psalm, was that what you said?
Yeah, that was good. Thank you. So sharing the gospel will be the greatest joy for them. Blessed, happy is the one whose transgression is forgiven. By the way, I'm just going to give you little hints along the way. I tell people this. Like, hey, don't be ashamed of calling on Jesus. Blessed is the one whose sins are forgiven. I know you're a sinner, but it's a blessed thing to say, I'm a sinner in need of a Savior, and I trust in Jesus. I tell them that. I show them that verse in the Bible, that it is not cursed. Ashamed be the one whose transgressions are forgiven. Because a lot of people think of it that way. I should be ashamed. It's like, well, honestly, I guess you should. But Jesus is the one who wipes away that shame and gives you that blessing. So that's what we have. We have first, man, these are all messed up. First, we have that God gets his glory. Love the Lord your God. God gets the glory through this. And then secondly, that the person, what is it? They have the opportunity for right worship and joy rather than hell. Those are our two reasons that we've gone through so far. The glory of God being primary, the other person being secondary. But still a main reason. By the way, just because something's a secondary reason doesn't mean it's not a big reason, right? anyway, we'll go that road too far. Number three, this is where we come in. Worshiping by sharing brings us great joy. This is the secondary reason as well. And so a lot of people feel bad. They say, I'm just going to do this so that I get joy. That's a bad thing. But I think that if we're seeking our joy, you know, like if we spend our life seeking joy in other things, they call that hedonism. You know, all you do is you seek joy, you seek joy, you seek joy. Then yes, that is a bad thing. But I do not think it's a bad thing to seek our joy in God, to say, I want to find my joy in you. And to seek our joy in others. I want to find my joy in you finding your joy in God. Does that make sense? Like, that is a good thing. Seeking our joy is only bad when it, like, puts other people out, almost, is a kind of way to look at it. And you can always think of the example of, so Hallie's my wife. If I were to say, I'm going to hang out with you tonight because I'm supposed to as your husband, like, is that glorifying or showing the worth of Hallie? Or is it just showing a sense of stoic duty? You know, like, I'm just going to do it. But if on the other hand I say, I don't know what I said, if I spit everywhere. But if I were to say, hey, I am going to hang out with you tonight because I like it to watch you smile. I like to serve you. I like to help you grow spiritually. I like to do all these things to grow your joy. She would say, that's great. I'm glad you want to do that. I'm glad you'll find joy in that. You take joy in my happiness. Like, that is so cool. And that shows that Hallie has value. She has so much value that I want to spend time with her. She has so much value that I want to pour into her, serve her, have to humble myself under her when I'm wrong, you know, as I did 20 minutes ago. Anyway, we'll leave that out. So anyways, like, that is the difference. So don't feel bad about seeking your joy in God. This is true for anything. You say, why do you read the Bible? Now, there is some, anyways, it doesn't matter. If you say, okay, I'm going to read my Bible every day People say this is legalistic. I'm going to read my Bible every day. You know why? Because I think God is my only source of joy and God speaks to me through his word. Tell me that's a bad thing. That shows the value of God, his strength. And so for us, we're in the same way. I'm going to share the gospel because it will bring me the greatest joy. It is one of the, brings great joy, maybe not greatest joy, because it is this worshiping God in this way brings me joy. You know what? I could do lots of things with my time. I could talk to people and never share the gospel with them. But God, I believe, is powerful enough, great enough, strong enough to give me a greater joy than just you know, hanging out with them and having a good time, or you know what I mean? Like God is greater. And that shows the worth of wanting God over being comfortable, the worth of wanting God over your fears, the worth of wanting God over just being put out. Because sometimes sharing the gospel means, I can go hang out with them. I didn't really, you know, want to tonight, but I'm going to. Anyways, I just wanted to, because we can get hung up on that. Like, oh, sharing gospel, it's all about me. Some people are too much like that. They're like, what does God have to do with sharing the gospel? And that's the way I was before. But anyways, so first here, sharing the story of Jesus is a privilege. Sharing the story of Jesus is a privilege. Someone want to read that for me?
But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for his own possession, that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who called you out of darkness into the marvelous light.
Thank you. And so what I see there is you're a chosen race. Like, this evidently is a good thing. A royal priesthood, a holy nation. So I think of a priesthood. What a priest did in the Old Testament was they led the rest of the nation of Israel in worship. They helped them to worship. They led them. They taught them. They showed them. They even, you know, helped them offer the sacrifices that they did under the law in these things. And so in the same way, we as Christians, it is our privilege, our great privilege, to proclaim the excellencies of him who called us out of darkness into his marvelous light. Like, we get to proclaim the excellencies. We get to lead people into worship that they wouldn't have gotten to before. That is an amazing privilege. It's even more of an amazing privilege when I think about what a dirty dog I am, that I can represent God, that I'm an ambassador for Christ, 2 Corinthians 5 says. Like, that is crazy. I mean, really, what a great privilege. The next one kind of follows this. Sharing gives you the opportunity to share in what God is doing. So we'll read that. It's a big one.
After this I looked, and behold, a great multitude that no one could number, from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed in white robes, with palm branches in their hands, and crying out with loud voice, "Salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb."
What I want to point out there is that these people were from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages. So people were converted from all these places, and all these people are now standing in front of the God of the universe, before his throne, proclaiming how great he is. Salvation belongs to our God and to the Lamb who sits on the throne. I think that's what it says. I don't know. Oh, God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb. Man, we get to be a part of that. Like, it would be cool, I'm not going to lie, if I were like Columbus, you know, made it in the history books. That'd be kind of cool. I don't know. But how much cooler to make it in the history book of God, that people are in heaven for eternity, a part of God's plan because of something that you did, that God graced you to do. And again, this is the same gospel that we feel this burden. Oh, I'm supposed to share the gospel. It's like, no. You get to be a part of the history of the cosmos, not just the history of America, or, you know, like, this is an amazing thing to be a part of what God is doing. The next one here, obedience brings us great joy. Anyone?
If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be full.
So, does God command us to share the gospel, yes or no?
Yes.
Yes. Does that mean that it has to be a hard duty that is wearisome and you know, toilsome on us? No. It doesn't mean that it won't be hard for the moment, but it means in the end it will be for the greatest joy even then. Jesus says, you know, you keep my commandments, you abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. these things, keeping my commandments, these things I have spoken to you, that my joy may be in you, and that your joy may be full. So, anything, I don't know, watching a football game, I'm not picking on football, I like football. Watching a football game, does it promise you fullness of joy? I can tell you it doesn't give it, whether or not it promises it. I was going to say, maybe it promises that, but it will fail you. It'll wear off. It really, really, really will. Any type of happiness outside of Jesus really will wear off. Fullness of joy is what Jesus offers. I don't know that we get this full joy here on earth, but I can tell you, you will be filled with joy in proportion to how well you obey him. Out of a heart of gratitude that says, again, I'm not earning my salvation by obeying you. I'm getting to enjoy you by obeying you. I'm getting to show your worthiness by obeying you. And so, I don't know. I really hate to use examples because I never know what people struggle with. I never know these things. But let's just say cupcakes are a sin, okay? We're using a bad example. Cupcakes are a sin, and you say, man, I'm going to enjoy God rather than this cupcake. And I can promise you, if you believe the Bible, that each and every time foregoing the cupcake and obeying God will be more joy-filled. It will bring you more joy. It's a hard thing to believe. And that really is like one of the main struggles of the Christian life. Will it really bring me more joy to do what God says than to do what I want to do? To take the easy road, the wide one. Anyway, it doesn't go well for the wide path with the wide gate. Anyway, so just remember that you are seeking your own highest joy in this. Now, I want to be careful and say don't focus so much on like, I'm going to get joy, but it should be a motivation, honestly. Jesus says, store up treasures in heaven, right? Jesus tells us to store up treasures in heaven. Like, he tells us to be motivated by joy in God. Anyway, I'm going to move off of that one. The great joy that is what we get. The next one, even when this causes suffering, it is a blessing to be used. Can someone read that one for me?
For it has been granted to you that for the sake of Christ, you should not only believe in him, but also suffer for his sake. Engaged in the same conflict that you saw I had and now hear that I still have.
Do you guys have other things below that?
No.
Other verses? Okay, because I did this later. I'll read Romans 5, because he says that it's been granted to you these things. And it's like, well, how can it be granted to suffer like that? But Romans 5, 3 through 5 says this. More than that, we rejoice in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope, and hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who's been given to us. So he said that. We rejoice in our suffering because of all these great things. It produces endurance, it produces hope. These things will not fail you. So I want to tell you, when sharing the gospel hurts, when it really causes suffering for you, know that it is producing something good in you. James 1, 2 through 4. Oh, James is harder to find. Oh, get it, found it. It's a smaller book. Alright. Count it all joy, my brothers, when you meet trials of various kinds. For you know that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness. And let steadfastness have its full effect, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing. So even when we suffer for the sake of righteousness, for the sake of sharing the faith, it is a good thing that we really can rejoice in. So when throughout these next weeks you start saying, fine, my coworker, I'm going to share with them, the dude at school, I'm going to share with them, like, I'm finally going to do it, the person I see at the gym, the person that I see at the gas station all the time, I'm going to do it, and it hurts, know that God is working in you to bring you a greater hope, a greater joy than you could ever have. So, quick review. Our primary reason for sharing the gospel is because God deserves to be worshipped and glorified, and he doesn't get it. We could say the reason that we study the Bible and do these things is so that we'll worship and glorify him more, as we change and are more made like Christ. But other people don't have that at all. They're dead in their trespasses and sins. They can't worship God in that way, but he deserves to be glorified. Secondly, it's for their good. man, help them out. Even if you don't like them, you know, do it for their good. This is the second greatest commandment, just behind loving the Lord your God. And then thirdly, it is for our good. This is a good thing for you. And what I really see in so many ways, and why one of the reasons I'm so excited about evangelism, is I really think that your relationship with God in your bedroom, in your office, wherever you spend time with Jesus, your relationship with God will 100% affect the way you evangelize and whether or not you evangelize, honestly. It will 100% affect it. Just know that. If you're not spending time with God, having a strong, vital relationship with God, you're probably not going to even remember or care to evangelize. But on the flip side, if you're pushing into Jesus, trying to grow in that way, and you're evangelizing, your evangelizing will help you to grow in that relationship with Jesus, I promise. Every time you look at the Matthew 28, what is that called? The Great Commission. He tells them, go and make disciples. And then he says, and behold, I am with you always to the end of the age. That happens over and over and over in Scripture. You see in Acts 1:8, that whole thing that we just studied, oh man, the Spirit will come upon you and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and Judea and all Samaria and to the ends of the earth. So you'll feel, you'll experience the Spirit, you'll experience Christ in a new way as you share the gospel. Some of that is the struggle of sharing the gospel. We'll push you to Jesus and saying, God, I need help. Like, I always get right there about to share the gospel. I'm about to say, hey, you want to know why I go to church? I'm about to change the conversation, and then I don't do it. God, I need you. That will push your relationship with Christ. And so I think it is one of the best ways to grow as a Christian is to be sharing Christ. I really do. I think some of the blessings are like your internal joy and stuff, but I think one of the blessings is you'll grow a lot faster. I've seen a lot of Christians stunted in their faith because they talk about it, that we're supposed to be a through road, not a cul-de-sac, you know? Like, we get all this information about God, it just sits in our stagnant little pond, you know? But it should be coming into us and then flowing out of us, you know? And it really does help us to grow. And other things we'll be talking about, you know, is like, what is the gospel? That'll be week 3. What is the gospel? There are a lot of people who cannot tell you what the gospel is. If I said, you, share the gospel with me, they wouldn't even hardly know it. Why is that? Because they haven't been evangelizing. And we'll talk, there's other reasons maybe, but they haven't been evangelizing, so they haven't even really thought through what the gospel is. Like, so sharing the gospel will sharpen you by God's grace. And so I'm excited about it. You guys have any thoughts or questions? And I'll let you get out of here.
I think one thing to remember is, I mean, there's no pressure, really, because, their salvation doesn't really hinge upon your performance mm-hmm. or what you can do.
Yes.
So that we can't boast.
Yeah.
And they have no excuses. So, I mean,
right.
You know, this is really just an opportunity for you to share
yes.
what God has done in your life.
Yes.
And there'll be rewards in heaven and
yep.
actually on earth as
yep.
well. That's where you get your joy.
No, that's wonderful. That's like a lot of what we'll talk about even next week is overcoming walls. One of our biggest fears is like, well, I'm just going to screw it up and, you know, they're going to become hardened to the gospel. I've even read good books that say that and I'm just like, they're headed to hell. Like, am I really like screwing them up that bad? Is there like some lower level of hell that I'm going to send them to because I shared the gospel badly? I mean, truly, I'm so with you. And then number two, like, it's not going to be me that saves them. It's going to be
yeah,
the Holy Spirit.
Right.
A lot of people have been saved by some really shabby gospel presentations, but God's good and helps us in it, helps us in our weakness. And yeah, absolutely. Thank
so,
you for
sometimes
adding that.
It's the unpolished.
Yes.
Presentation because it's more genuine.
Mm-hmm.
If you have this extremely polished presentation and it sounds like something written out of a text,
right. Yes.
They're not going to see it as genuine
yes.
and they're not going to really.
No, you're exactly right.
As much.
And that's that I told you, like, man, I'm going to hear more than just learning methods of sharing the gospel, you will learn a mindset of how to be a bright light in the dark world. That's on your syllabus. More than just methods, like, here's, I'm going to say this, then I'm going to say this, I'm going to say this. I want you to have a mindset of, like, look, I want this person to know how awesome God is. I want them to know what will happen if they don't recognize how awesome God is, you know, and I want to be the one to share it to them. Like, that should be what pushes us, because I totally agree. And hardly give people a time of day that come knocking on my door with a notebook in front of them and, you know, okay, he said no, so now I need to say this. That does not work, definitely not with my generation, and I don't know if it really worked in any generation at all. The whole memorized rote thing doesn't mean you can't memorize some things, but I totally agree. But that's what we want, and that's why today, I think for it to flow out genuinely, you have to see the glory of God. You have to see the horror of hell, right? And the joy of sharing with them. Like, once those things get more aligned in your heart and in your mind, the gospel will flow out, you know. But we'll cover overcoming walls next week in a little more detail. It says, okay, make my mind think that way. It's like, well, we'll talk about how you make your mind think these ways a little bit more. But yeah, I agree. The written conversations, it just doesn't work. There's a lot of good studies or whatever you call them, methods that they're good.
Old booklets.
Yeah, and they've been used well. Yeah.
Jeff, are you going to get into at all how to break it down for kids?
Yeah,
maybe
I would.
Some of that.
That's a great idea. I'll write it down. I don't have a pen. Everyone else has a pen. But I would say, like, when we get to what is the gospel, which is week 3, that'll be a big part of it, because it really does. I think at some point in my life, if you'd asked me the gospel, I'd have started, you know, I'd have started with creation or whatever. Then I'd have talked about Abraham and Noah and Moses, and it's just like, whoa! I just asked what the gospel is, you know, like I don't. It was so muddled in my mind. The way I always think of it is, I had a bunch of facts all in my mind, all over the place, and finally, like, the gospel, just the straight-up creation, fall, Christ response, like, that type of thing, was the gears that finally made all those other pieces of information make sense. And so I want to, on that week, distill it to be so simple, the gospel to be so simple, that it could be kids, or it could be someone with a doctorate, because it'll make sense of Abraham. If they ask questions, well, what about Abraham? It's like, well, here's how that actually points to creation, fall, Christ's response, you know. And so, yeah, that's a great point, though. I can make sure that we have good ways. And if you have ideas, even, or other people, it'll be helpful, you know.
It's just so, you know, I know that I share with my class a lot. Of course, I have special needs kids, too.
Right.
And just trying to, of course, you know, I need to step out of the way, you know, because it is, you know, hindrance myself, because I find myself trying to do it myself instead of letting the Holy Spirit lead me sometimes.
Right.
But just, you know, it's just, you know, just they don't understand those typical terms of Jesus in my heart, or, you know, they literally think he's going to, you know, this whole person's going to put inside of, you know, it's just, you know, if you could just kind of break it down.
No, I mean, and more and more, what's interesting is the longer I've been sharing the gospel, the more I've had to stop using the Christian word. And because at first all my group were a bunch of people who went to Christian school that did drugs, you know, so they knew all the words. They didn't love Jesus, so I could use those words with them. But, I mean, full disclosure, again, this isn't for puffing up me, but a couple days ago to a contractor in our house working on it, I'm sharing the gospel, and I'd say words like righteousness, and he's just kind of like, I'm like, well, what I mean by that is, like, to have right standing before God, you know. And even that, I'm like, ugh, what am I? Like, been in seminary too long, using all these churchy words. But no, I think that's great. And so that will be, I mean, just a preview to what is the gospel. Creation, pound that in, that God created us, you know. Like, and so that would be, like, where I'd start with a kid. Sin means absolutely nothing if God didn't create us and own us. You know, so, like, to tell someone they're a sinner before creation really doesn't help. You know, so that'd be, like, for a child, you have to ingrain those things. And I think there is, you know, there are building blocks, a process you have to take them through. And you can look at it with, like, Paul in Acts. Like, sometimes he'd share the gospel, and he would just go straight to Christ. But that was when he was talking to Jews, you know, who they already knew God created the heavens and the earth.
Right.
But then when he's talking to, I can't remember what you call him. Huh?
Gentiles.
Thank you. Talking to Gentiles, he would start with, this one created us, and he's, you know, all things come through him and stuff, and then Christ. And so he had to think through those things as well of where does that kid go to church, you know, in Sunday school every week? Or, you know, so even that would make a difference for how we do it. Anything else? My nose held up. I was afraid of that. By the end of this, in front of my shirt, it's just covered in snot. Keep going. But yeah, thanks so much. And I do. I encourage you guys to share the gospel. You know, and one of the things we'll talk about next week is overcoming walls to sharing. And one of the walls is I don't know the gospel well enough to share it. We'll get there. So if you're not there yet, then maybe wait a couple weeks. You know, but be looking, be praying, guys. I'm telling you, I don't know how many times it'll hit me. I say, man, I haven't shared the gospel in a while. God, help me to find someone. And it'll be like 30 minutes later. Not always quite that fast, but God really is not, he's not afraid to glorify himself, you know, by using you to share him and stuff. So I encourage you, I don't want to push evangelism over and above just a relationship with Jesus, because that will be the gas that drives this, you know, that being filled with the Spirit, energized by the Spirit, however you want to say that. Does that make sense? So I want to encourage that as well, because, yeah, the Pharisees, they did it all right, but they didn't have the heart relationship. Well, cool. Does anyone want to pray us out? I pray this in. Someone's welcome to.